The passage which I remember as being this kind of recitative against slowly changing harmonies of a different rhythm is... slow, soft harmonies changing constantly in the background against this very...
Well, you have that also in 90 plus. There's the same sort of thing right at the beginning. It's something that interests me very much because I think that in a way this is the way we experience many things, the idea that there's one thing that comments on another constantly in our lives, in our music. And a lot of people at a concert are thinking about something else while Beethoven is being played, not putting that in the piece.
It is music for the modern world, quite
well,
clearly. You know,
one tries to do it, of course. Modern world's having a hard time being modern.
Yes. These passages have always fascinated me in the music that, where, I mean, you have two seemingly independent systems which are going along as if one wasn't paying any attention to the other, and yet, of course, they make very beautiful music together. The most spectacular example is the third quartet, which is really... two duos playing entirely different series of movements at the same time.
Yes, well, of course, they sound as if they are independent of each other, but they're really not.
No, I mean, of course,
it's,
yeah.
It's all carefully calculated. For instance, I try to avoid traffic jams and this kind of thing. I try to keep them one clear from the other. And then in the end, they all are concerned with the basic harmonic structure so that there's a sound pattern that unifies these diverse materials into one sound, and which I'm very concerned with. It may not be evident to the listener, but it's very evident to me.
Well, one of the most convincing things in your music is the harmony is very often calculated along with the rhythm. For example, I remember in the piano concerto that certain intervals like sixths, which are that sort of have a heavy slow motion and...
That's right.
That's that minor seconds go much faster, so that...
I also felt that in a case like that, that each one of the intervals had its own character of feeling, mm-hmm. and therefore I tried to isolate different strands of music, not only by interval, but by rhythm, so that I tried to keep them separate, so that you would hear one line like those six going up from the bass as a thing in itself, and this gives it a character and an identity of its own. I've tried to keep these different strands and different identities separate. For instance, at the opening of 90 plus, there's a heavy chords and then there's single notes which are played against them in staccato, staccato against these held chords. And each one of them has a different type of playing. One, there are two different kinds of staccato, a longer sort of attack and then a staccato attack against this. And I've tried to keep all that separate. And they also have different intervals melodically. But I must say that it's not easy for the poor pianist or the poor performer to keep all this separate.
It
must be very confusing.
The one stumbling block that listeners find in your music, the problem is not what's there, is they expect something that isn't there. They expect to hear one kind of unified rhythm that's going to give them a downbeat, and what happens is that you very often have contradictory rhythms with contradictory downbeats, and they keep listening for a downbeat. This particularly, I notice, true with orchestral pieces. They see the conductor's hand go down with a nice, what should be a thump, and they're not getting the thump, so that a lot of music is made intelligible to an audience by the gestures of the conductor, and that's not going to work with your music because...
Well, let me say that, of course, since I come from a generation of people who were very concerned with music before the Romantic and even before the Baroque period, when music was not measured out in bar lines the way it later became, and in music like Monteverdi and many madrigals, the conductor beats time, but there isn't a thump on the downbeat. The way that came to be, especially in German music and even in French music by the 17th and 18th century. Yeah. So that my music is really, a lot of it has been derived from a knowledge of music of the Renaissance and even before that. And in fact, there were even rhythmic experiments in those early days that were very influential in the early part of my music.
It's an old romantic dream. There's Schumann's review of Berlioz saying that, perhaps Berlioz is the man who will release us from the tyranny of the bar line, so that music should be produced like the nightingale who doesn't sing with bar lines. There's no conductor for the, you know. And it is this idea of this kind of free developing rhythm in a way which you actually do start with the piano sonata and which then goes on to different forms of freely developing contradictory rhythms and which makes the music so fascinating for us.
Let me say also that part of this comes from having listened to jazz of that particular period of the 50s in which there was a regular beat and then an improvisation against it, frequently not following the beat at all. Mm. And my music really has developed this idea to a much greater extent. It doesn't sound like jazz, but it really comes from this particular point of view. I remember hearing that even in the time of the waltz period, that waltzes were played that way. And I remember that my teacher, Nadia Boulanger, used to play examples of Chopin, the way Paderewski played it, and Paderewski kept the left hand very regular, which beat the time, and the right hand played in a much more improvisatory way, as if it was not connected directly with the rhythm.
Well, that is the old definition of rubato, that the left hand plays in time and the right hand deviates, and that's what Mozart used to play like that. It actually means that you're not playing with your hands together, but I mean, and that most people don't realize.
You see, what I'm doing is very old-fashioned.